In this article, I will expose Leonard Sweet as a postmodernist who apparently is so caught up in his postmodern paradigm shift that he's unable to think clearly at all, let alone teach. On his video called The Double Ring Video by Leonard Sweet, Sweet's Soul Cafe 1998, Volume 3, which, by the way, I've transcribed in totality, you can hear the bell toll twice, announcing the demise of Christianity, falling headlong into a global apostate end times world false religion. Now I want to go through Sweet's video line by line for accuracy, but first I want to make some general comments. Leonard Sweet is probably the main intelligentsia that the emerging church movement has at the moment. The reason I say this is not because what he's saying is anything new or earth-shattering or even applicable to Christianity, frankly. I say it because what Sweet is trying to do in redefining postmodernism for Christian context will probably only convince postmodernists who have had their brains turned to mush by the New Age, TV, and most of what passes for Christianity in modern megachurches today. The younger generation has been systematically trained to shut off their brains and feel sideways instead of sharpening their God-given minds with the truth of God's Word. What Sweet is proposing is that Christians need to help along this postmodern worldview process by spouting the same nonsense as the world does at the moment. What Sweet is teaching is, though, nothing less than Eastern mysticism, which I'll show in a moment. But first I want to comment on his statements in the video. And, you know, I'm sure this article is viewed by as completely modernist approach by the likes of Sweet.
One of the most fundamental distinctions between modern and postmodern culture is the way in which in the modern world to do ministry, you had to go to the center. To do ministry in a postmodern world, you have to go to the edge. In postmodern culture, opposite things happen at the same time and they are not contradictory. The modern world created big middles. It loved big middles. The modern world created a mass culture. Middle class, middle management.
Now, of course, there's no proof given for this thesis other than to make analogies that have nothing to do with modernism. The facts of the middle class are currently as follows, according to a study. A new study supports the hypothesis of a shrinking middle. The declining portion of families in the middle has largely moved to the upper class, although the share of income by the lower class has declined. This article describes the nature and results of such sensitivity analysis, and that's from BLS.gov. The facts are that the middle class are now being categorized as upper class, and the income of the lower class is also shrinking. Looks like the move is mainly from the middle to the upper edge, not from the middle to the lower edge. That there is dissatisfaction with middle management jobs is not a new issue, but to claim that there is a great move from the middle to the upper or lower at the same time, management positions or other jobs, remains to be seen. Unless, of course, companies play some kind of bait and switch by calling middle management jobs something else. Suffice it to say, though, that Sweet's examples are basically pulled out of thin air in order to try to make his point. But the facts do not back up his claim that there's a big change due to the move from modernism to postmodernism in terms of business or the economy, which he's obviously addressing. But let's look at Sweet's definition of modernism as the love of the middles compared to what it's actually defined as in Merriam-Webster Dictionary. Modernism, a practice, usage, or expression peculiar to modern times, a tendency in theology to accommodate traditional religious teaching to contemporary thought, and especially to devalue supernatural elements, modern artistry or literary philosophy and practice, especially a self-conscious break with the past and a search for new forms of expression. Now, for an excellent article on modernism, which Sweet should have read, rather than trying to redefine modernism from a postmodernist perspective, it can be found at Wikipedia. It states this: the most controversial aspect of the modern movement was and remains its rejection of tradition, both in organization and in the immediate experience of the work. This dismissal of tradition also involved the rejection of conventional expectations, hence modernism often stresses freedom of expression, experimentation, radicalism, and primitivism. Now, does this sound like loving the middle, or middle management, or middle class to you? So, Sweet's basic thesis for this video is already an error. The second idea is that the postmodern world is on the cutting edge, on the edge, by believing that opposite things can happen and not be contradictory. Just to enlighten postmodernists, they're not the first people to discover this fact. This concept is called a paradox, someone or something with qualities or features that seem to conflict with one another, or an antinomy, which is a contradiction between two apparently equally valid principles. Now, an antinomy exists when two apparently opposite things are both true. But Sweet's upcoming examples are not just of antinomies, but of oxymorons. An oxymoron is something as a concept that's made up of contradictory or incongruous elements conjoining contradictory terms. Incongruous, of course, means lacking congruity, not harmonious, incompatible, not conforming, disagreeing. Contradictory means a position so related to another that if either of the two is true, the other is false, and if either is false, the other must be true. So an oxymoron is two concepts that negate each other with reference to truth. An antinomy is two concepts that are both mutually true and don't cancel each other out, even if they look opposite. Emerging church would be a good example, for instance, of an oxymoron, emerging church, since the church is not emerging, but it's continuing since its inception in the first century. If the church is emerging, then it cannot be continuing. The term emerging church, then, is an oxymoron. But I digress. The postmodernists are not on the cutting edge unless it's the edge of idiocy mixed with egotism. This would be an antinomy in their case, both being true at the same time. If they think they're on the edge of some kind of greater understanding of the universe because they recognize the concepts of antinomy and oxymoron, they are narcissistic egotists. But if they think that they can understand the universe better by mixing the concepts of antinomy and oxymoron together as being one and the same, they're idiotic. If Sweet is a voice for postmodernists in the church, then we are in bigger trouble than we all know. He goes on.
What's happening in postmodern culture is all of those middles are flattening. And there's a mitosis of the middles as the middle gets almost non-existent and the ends get huge.
Since I've already debunked Sweet's attempt at the redefinition of terms in the first part, it would seem redundant to continue, but Sweet goes on to attempt to redefine the term mitosis. Mitosis actually means a process that takes place in the nucleus of a dividing cell, involving typically a series of steps consisting of prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase, and results in the formation of two new nuclei, each having the same number of chromosomes as the parent nucleus. Now, the cell does not die out when it reproduces. It becomes two like itself, exactly like itself. So what Sweet is saying, which he does not mean, is that modernism is spawning two middles on the edge called postmodernism. I don't think this was his intent. Sweet is misusing big terminology that his adherents are about as likely to look up in the dictionary as they are to read their Bibles daily. But the point is that Sweet's analogy makes no sense because he's apparently trying to contrast modernism with postmodernism. So far, he's not doing a very good job. Perhaps the use of the term meiosis would have been better. Meiosis means the presentation of a thing with underemphasis, especially in order to achieve a greater effect. Or understatement, the cellular process that results in the number of chromosomes in gamete-producing cells being reduced to one half, and which involves a reproduction, a reduction division, in which one of each pair of the homologous chromosomes passes to each daughter cell in a mitotic division. We'll see that Sweet does indeed teach that the ends justify the means. He's underemphasizing modernism, using the Hegelian dialectic, thesis-antithesis, in order to achieve a greater effect of elevating postmodernism to a higher way of thinking and being. But the effect of Sweet's New Age teachings end up reducing the number of true believers by division. This is what all false teachers do. Romans 16:17, I urge you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause divisions and put obstacles in your way that are contrary to the teaching you have learned. Keep away from them. By the way, the teaching you have learned is talking about apostolic teaching. Titus 3:10 says, warn a divisive person once and then warn them a second time. After that, have nothing to do with him.
I are both energy and matter. You and I are both spirit and substance. This double ring, and that's why I just say the postmodernist always rings twice. This double ring is pervasive in this culture. That's why postmodern culture loves oxymorons so much. Let me give you some examples.
It is true that we are both energy and matter, as far as we understand the laws of the universe today. This is not an example of either an antinomy or oxymoron, but two things that together make one whole and are both true. They are not contrasting or opposite, but are both part of the fabric of existence. We are also both spirit and substance, but Sweet forgets, on purpose, to mention that we are more than just body and soul. We are actually a tripartite being, body, soul, or mind, and spirit, according to the Bible. Now, this is evidence that Sweet is a dualist, not a tripartist. Dualists do not understand one of the basics about human life. We are made in the image of God, who is a Trinity, and our existence as tripartite human beings is a reflection of the divine nature of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But suffice it to say, the body and spirit could be viewed as an antinomy, but certainly not an oxymoron. Sweet goes on to give a lot of examples of what he claims postmodern culture deems to be oxymorons.
Examples of the double ring phenomenon at work. Can you hear the double ring? What is light? Light is particle. Light is wave. Can you hear the double ring? We're living in a in-your-face society, and we want to get out of my face society. Can you hear the double ring? The more private issues are, the more media wants to make them public. Can you hear the double ring? Our televisions are getting bigger, and our televisions are getting smaller. People are throwing away more than ever before, and they're recycling more than ever before. Can you hear the double ring? People are getting more back to nature, more unplugged, and people are getting more computerized and more high-tech. Can you hear the double ring? Churches are getting bigger, and churches are getting small. Can you hear the double ring? The rich are getting richer, and the poor are getting poorer. By the way, what are the two precise groups the church is least prepared to minister with? Can you hear the double ring? The size of homes people are building is getting bigger, and family household size is getting small. Can you hear the double ring? And you hear the double ring. Americans spend the most money on decorations for two holidays. Christmas, where we celebrate love, hope, peace, joy, and Halloween, where we come to terms with the dark forces of the universe. We are living in this massive double ring, and to hit only one ring is to sound a half-truth.
Now, to hit only one ring, what's that? Sweet uses the Hegelian dialectic at least twice in this list, once when he accuses Christians of not reaching out to the poor or the rich, and again when he makes an indictment that the church is only selling half-truths. This is the thesis-antithesis way of brainwashing Christians by vilifying the past and elevating the present. But let's examine what Sweet is calling oxymoronic. Light is particle and wave, but it's neither antinomic or oxymoronic. By the way, he uses this repeated phrase, can you hear the double ring, over and over, and you know what? That's a brainwashing technique used in cults. The argument about postmodernists not wanting an in-your-face society is also not oxymoronic. It's a clear choice, according to Sweet, and that they want society out of their faces. On private issues, this is also not oxymoronic. It's a cause and effect. It's about the media wanting to make a buck and the public crying out for more. There's nothing contradictory about this morass at all. TV's getting bigger with HDTV for home viewing, and TV's getting smaller like webcast is also not oxymoronic. They're not contradictory, nor are they antinomical. Since there's more trash, the choice to recycle or throw things away is not oxymoronic. It's two options for the same trash. I don't know if you can call exercising in the park and taking a hike getting back to nature, but taking a cell phone along is common sense, not oxymoronic. Talk to people in China or Africa about getting back to nature. Churches are getting bigger because certain people want to play megachurch and study the purpose-driven life instead of the Bible. churches are getting smaller because the mega churches are draining the smaller churches who cannot out-entertain, out-latte, or out-talk story the mega churches. That's not oxymoronic. It's a choice people are making, and the move to big mega churches is often a bad choice. The rich and poor, they'll always be with us. It's not oxymoronic to be poor or rich, only if you claim that you're both poor and rich materially at the same time, which is impossible. But apparently not in the universe of Len Sweet. Where has he been anyway, when the major job of feeding the poor has been an ongoing mission of the Christian churches for decades in missions? Who does he think he is doing? Who does he think is doing a good job feeding the poor? UNICEF? United Way? What a joke. True biblical churches have always reached out to every class of people. That's diaprax. Just because a family chooses to have less children and build bigger houses does not an oxymoron make. Family size is usually a mirror of cultural sensibilities. House size is due to rising two-family incomes in the U.S. and a desire to be in debt for the rest of your natural life, but that's not oxymoronic at all. Now we come to some serious Eastern mystical dualism. We are led to believe by Sweet that Christians and Halloween are either oxymoronic, number one, or number two, antinomic. They cannot be oxymoronic because they're not the same thing. So apparently he means them to be antinomical. In other words, they are the flip side of one coin, which would mean they look opposite, but they're just a yin-yang expression of a good and evil force. You know, I didn't know that Halloween was about coming to terms with the dark forces of the universe. Cue Darth Vader. I thought that Halloween is a corrupted, institutionalized, culturalized version of All Hallows' Eve, which is the eve before the Catholics on All Saints' Day attempt to pray the dead out of purgatory. Silly me. But Sweet betrays his theology here. He's attempting to subtly teach that opposites are really both sides of one thing, and that is Eastern mysticism. It reminds me of watching Bhagwan Sri Rajneesh on TV in Oregon stating that good is evil and evil is good. Is this where Sweet is leading his postmodern minds full of mush? Apparently Sweet has been studying Eastern religions in the New Age rather than the Bible. Here are what some in the tradition of Sweet have been teaching for ages. Evil is good or truth misplaced, Mohandas Gandhi. Good is evil and evil is good. Good is good and evil is evil. That's Cristo el Diablo. He's a satanic follower. Yang cannot exist by itself. It can exist only when it's supported by yin. Hence, yin is the foundation of yang. Similarly, yin cannot alone manifest itself. It can manifest only when accompanied by yang. Hence, yang is the expression of yin. Yang controls the origination and enjoys the completion of things. When yin follows the way, yang produces and completes the work of yang. And by the way, that's Xiao Yong, who was a Confucianism philosopher. Perhaps Sweet is trying to vilify the middle while glorifying the ends. There are two sides to every issue. One side is right and the other is wrong, but the middle is always evil. That's Ayn Rand, who was a Russian-born American writer and novelist. In any case, this is Eastern mysticism and has nothing to do with the biblical definition of good and evil. Christmas celebrates the birth of Christ, though it too has pagan rituals mixed in. Halloween, as an expression in our culture, celebrates evil. Perhaps Sweet has not been around Christian children for a while, but most Christians no longer celebrate Halloween because they've realized it's not just a harmless storybook fantasy, but has been evolving into a day that celebrates evil. Most churches I know have switched over to some different type of celebration instead for the kids, where they are taught biblical concepts and offer up praise and thanksgiving to the Lord.
Ancient future church.
This phrase is supposed to be some kind of backmasking, like the "do you hear the double ring" thing. But what does it mean? I believe it means he's trying to marry the ancient church to postmodernism, Catholicism to Protestantism. But this does not work because postmodernists do not understand the concept of objective reality, which they must be taught to understand or they cannot be saved, nor can they grow to maturity in Christ. We're not here to wed these concepts, but to contrast them and teach a generation a biblical worldview.
Christianity is a double ring. Jesus was fully God and Jesus was fully human. In Jesus, the ultimate became intimate. Jesus is the lion and Jesus is the lamb. Jesus is Alpha and Jesus is Omega. Modern was either or. Postmodern, more than both and, it's and also. Can we in our ministry hit double rings and in future multiple rings for the glory of God? Here is the fundamental challenge of ministry in postmodern culture. If you hug the middle of the road, you're going to be hit by both sets of oncoming traffic.
Jesus being the God-man is not an oxymoron. This might be a good example of an antinomy. The lion and the lamb symbolism is neither oxymoronic nor antinomic, though. It is typology of the attitudes of Jesus Christ, who is himself neither an actual lamb or lion, but a glorified man in heaven with his Father at his right hand. Alpha and Omega could be an antinomy, but it's really an expression of his divinity, his timelessness. Christians from the first century through the modernists did not see these ideas as either or, but clearly understood the concepts of antinomy. That postmodernists think this is an oxymoron shows they are the ones who do not understand these concepts. How ironic. Now we come to the crux. Sweet wants to marry Eastern mysticism and any other concept that strikes his fancy to Christianity in order to attract this postmodern generation. He doesn't just want both and, but wants and also. This is telling. If we take this to the logical conclusion, Sweet doesn't want Jesus Christ to be God and man, but he also wants him to be pantheistic, postmodern, tolerant of other religions, and intolerant of the biblical middle-of-the-road Christians as he sees it. How can mixing everything together in a big pot be bringing glory to God? Hasn't Sweet read about how the Israelites tried to do this many times in their adaptation of other religious practices and ended up in bringing judgment on themselves? The bottom line in this video is the statement, if you hug the middle of the road, or in other words, orthodoxy, then you'll be hit by the postmodern culture from both sides and will not be able to cope. The truth of the matter, if the postmodernists can even possibly understand objective truth, is that the only way Christians can be effective witnesses in a postmodern world is to stand for truth. The truth of the gospel and the objective, holy, inerrant Word of God. Sweet wants Christians to hide their light under a bushel of postmodern garbage so they will fit in. The upshot is, what Sweet is teaching is clearly not oxymoronic, but you know what? Take away the oxy, and I think you'll understand what I'm talking about. This is an article that I wrote after giving further thought to the definition of postmodernism given by the likes of postmodernist Leonard Sweet and other emerging church promoters. My article refuting Sweet's attempt at redefining and legitimizing postmodernism is called Ding Dong, Ding Dong, Wake Up, Leonard Sweet. You know, it dawned on me that the enemy is certainly behind the postmodern paradigm and especially behind those who want to buy into this ridiculous worldview instead of roundly refuting it. Contrary to the egotistical claims of postmoderns that they are on the cutting edge because of their subjectivist, relativist, existential view of reality, this concept was actually foisted on the universe and the world by Satan himself before the world was created. Let's go through what we know of Lucifer from the biblical records. I think you'll see clearly that Satan was the first postmodernist. He was way ahead of his time. So let's look at Lucifer in heaven. Isaiah 14:12 through 15 says, "How you have fallen from heaven, O morning star, son of the dawn. You have been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the mount of the assembly, on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. But you are brought down to the grave, to the depths of the pit. Isaiah 14:12 in the KJV says, How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? Ezekiel 28:14-16 says, You were anointed as a guardian cherub, for so I ordained you. You were on the holy mount of God. You walked among the fiery stones. You were blameless in your ways from the day you were created, till wickedness was found in you. Through your widespread trade, you were filled with violence and you sinned. So I drove you in disgrace from the mount of God, and I expelled you, O guardian cherub, from among the fiery stones. Revelations 12:4-9 says, His tail swept a third of the stars out of the sky and flung them to the earth. The dragon stood in front of the woman who was about to give birth so that he might devour her child the moment it was born. She gave birth to a son, a male child, who will rule all the nations with an iron scepter. And her child was snatched up to God and to his throne. The woman fled to the desert to a place prepared for her by God where she might be taken care of for 1,260 days. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil, or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. And finally, Revelations 22 says, He seized the dragon, that ancient serpent, who is the devil, or Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. Now, Satan was created a blameless angel, but with free will, like the other angels, and he was the anointed guardian cherub in heaven. He walked on the holy mount of God among the fiery stones. He was called the morning star, son of dawn. Yet Lucifer was not satisfied. He did not like the fact that God was being worshipped and he was not. This was just not fair. In Lucifer's view, there was intolerance in heaven. After all, he was the most beautiful, most powerful angel there. If God was worshipped as God, then Lucifer must be a god also. So Lucifer said to himself, I will ascend. I will make myself like the Most High. Lucifer became the first New Ager by saying, I am God. He became the first postmodernist by failing to grasp objective reality and instead embarking on an interpretation of the facts that suited his purposes. We can look back on these events and wonder how Satan could have possibly thought for even a moment that he could be God. But then we have millions of people on earth today who also claim to be God. Foolishness is not the domain of Satan alone, but he is the father of it and the father of anyone who says that they are a god in lieu of the facts of objective truth, that there is only actually one God, YHWH, eternally existing in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That's 1 Corinthians 8:6, Ephesians 4:6, Matthew 28:19, Galatians 4:6. You know, the moment the thought of godhood and rebellion blossomed in Lucifer's mind, he was sentenced to death. So too are all who sin against God without repentance. The issue is not one of fairness, it's one of recognizing objective truth. For the postmodernist, truth is relative, subjective, a thing to be manipulated, a thing that flows and moves with time and space. To God and to any true follower of Jesus Christ, that's foolishness. God set the rules. They are objective truth, and they must be followed. This is his universe, not that of Satan or anyone else. Yet the first man and woman committed the same postmodernist sin as Lucifer did. Let's look at that, the serpent in the garden, Genesis 3:1-7. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other of the wild animals the Lord had made. He said to the woman, Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? The woman said to the serpent, We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, You must not eat fruit from the tree that's in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. You will not surely die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Unable to sway God with his arguments and attitude, Satan was cast down to earth, taking one-third of the angels of heaven with him in rebellion. Not satisfied to corrupt many angels, Satan now saw the opportunity to pawn off his New Age mysticism on Adam and Eve. He used the Hegelian dialectic and praxis and started the dialogue with a question. Posing questions that lead to a predetermined conclusion is a typical device used by postmodernists. Satan questioned whether God really said what he said. Well, maybe they just heard it wrong. But the real postmodern question lurks beneath. How could God make a demand like that on you? Is it really fair? Has God really given you free will? I thought you had all your options open. Eve should have told the serpent to take a hike at this point, but the diaprax had captured her imagination. She gave the right answer, but failed to send the serpent away for daring to challenge God. Then Satan did his most famous dance around the truth. He gave a heaping dose of truth with just enough hell in it to change the lives of human beings forever, if they would accept it. Satan was also the first heretic, laying error alongside of truth. Now, it was true that Adam and Eve would not die physically immediately on the spot. It was not true that they would not die because they would, both spiritually and eventually physically. It was true that their eyes would be opened after eating the fruit. What Satan failed to tell them was that their eyes would only be open to evil. They already knew good. What they did not know was evil. But the biggest lie slipped into the middle of Satan's diaprax was that you will be like God. Adam and Eve were made in the image of God. They were already like God in sinless blamelessness. Not only would they not become like God, they would be separated from God with no way to atonement, except by repentance and the shedding of blood. They would destroy the nature God had wanted for them by putting on a sin nature. They would be estranged from God, Psalms 58:3, and desperately wicked, Jeremiah 17:9, from that point on. Satan is still selling this diaprax today. The postmodern generation thinks they can get closer to God, have a relationship with God, through the apple of New Age practices. They think they can reform God in their own image. In fact, they believe they are little gods. But they've been fooled by the first postmodernist, Satan. Let's look at the case of the devil and Cain, John 8:48. You belong to your father the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desire. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Jude 1:11, woe to them, they have taken the way of Cain. They have rushed for profit into Balaam's error. They have been destroyed in Korah's rebellion. Genesis 4:1-16 says, Adam laid with his wife, and she became pregnant and gave birth to Cain. She said, with the help of the Lord, I have brought forth a man. Later, she gave birth to his brother Abel. Now, Abel kept flocks, and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. But Abel brought fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. Then the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what's right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must master it. Now Cain said to his brother Abel, let's go out to the field. And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is your brother Abel? I don't know, he replied. Am I my brother's keeper? The Lord said, what have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you're under a curse and driven from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it will no longer yield its crops for you. You will be a restless wanderer on the earth. Cain said to the Lord, My punishment is more than I can bear. Today you are driving me from the land, and I will be hidden from your presence. I will be a restless wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me. But the Lord said to him, Not so. If anyone kills Cain, he will suffer vengeance seven times over. Then the Lord put a mark on Cain so that no one who found him would kill him. So Cain went out from the Lord's presence and lived in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Now who inspired Cain to kill his brother, committing the first murder? It was certainly Satan, because the Bible says that he was a murderer from the beginning. Satan tempted Cain, and Cain gave in to his sinful nature. The temptation was one of postmodern sensibilities. The devil whispered in Cain's ear that God was being unfair. So what that God had shown that sin only can be forgiven through the shedding of blood by the killing of the first animals to make clothing for Adam and Eve? Surely Cain could chart his own path and worship God in his own way. Then Cain killed his brother and lied to God when asked about his brother. When confronted with the facts of their sins, postmodernists will, rather than confess and repent them, often hide them under lies and justifications. The devil is the one who inspires lies, murder, false justifications, false teaching, rebellion, and unrepentance. Let's go on to the case of the devil and the temptation of Jesus Christ, Matthew 4:1-11. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Jesus answered, It is written, Man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down, for it's written, He will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus answered him, It's also written, Do not put the Lord your God to the test. Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. All this I will give you, he said, if you will bow down and worship me. Jesus said to him, Away from me, Satan, for it is written, Worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended him. Now notice the diaprax of Satan in his three attempts to tempt Christ. He tries to get Jesus to prove he has power by making himself something to eat. This appeals to the humanity of Christ on the level of body and soul. But for Christ to break his fast and use his divine power after making himself nothing, Philippians 2:7, in obedience to the will of the Father, would have been the end of salvation for men. Postmodernism appeals to the mind and to the flesh and seeks to satisfy the desires of them, but it's ignorant of the things of the Spirit. In the second temptation, Satan tries the same tactic, only this time he pulls Scripture out from its context to do so. This is another mark of postmodernist teachers. They pull what they want out of context from the Scripture to serve their own paradigm, their own agenda. Many postmodernists are fooled by this ploy because they don't bother to look up the biblical context to see if it's correct. They don't bother because, well, frankly, critical thinking is not part of their daily existence. Facts don't really matter to them. It's how they feel about what they hear and how it fits into their sensibilities. But Jesus rejects this false argument because he's the author of the Scriptures and knows their context. He rejects this temptation with Scripture that is not taken out of context but used according to it. The third temptation is Satan's grandest attempt. He knows that Jesus is on a mission to save men from sin and who believe in him and must die in order to achieve it. Satan tempts Christ to take the dominion of the world from Satan, who is called the ruler of the kingdom of the air, Ephesians 2:2, the prince of the world, of this world, John 12:31. Jesus knows that the whole world is under the control of the evil one, 1 John 5:19. So this was a real offer. Jesus could have the world now instead of going through pain and suffering if he would just simply worship Satan. But Satan failed to realize this offer was not what Jesus wanted. He did not need the world. He wanted to save people. The world would be his because he created it, Colossians 1:16. But this world would be destroyed, 2 Peter 3:10. In the course of time, the devil and his angels would be thrown into the lake of fire forever, Revelations 20:10. Satan's goal had been from the time of his sin in heaven that God would worship him. Like postmodernists, the facts did not persuade Satan. What mattered to him was his personal agenda that it be fulfilled, come hell or high water. In this case, come hell. What about the case of false apostles, false prophets, and false teachers with regard to Satan? Well, 2 Corinthians 11:13 through 15 says, "For such men are false apostles, deceitful workmen, masquerading as apostles of Christ, and no wonder, for Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. It's not surprising, then, if his servants masquerade as servants of righteousness. Their end will be what their actions deserve." 2 Peter 2:1-2, "But there were also false prophets among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you. They will secretly introduce destructive heresies, even denying the sovereign Lord who bought them, bringing swift destruction on themselves. Many will follow their shameful ways and will bring the way of truth into disrepute." 1 John 4:1 says, "Dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world." Finally, we have to deal with the issue of false apostles, prophets, and teachers. False apostles pretend they're serving the Lord, but actually they're serving their master, Satan. They may not even realize they're serving Satan, but you can only serve one master, according to Matthew 6:24. Postmodernists do not realize that you cannot serve God if you're serving yourself and your own agenda your own way. Like Satan before them, they serve their own desires instead of God. Thus, they end up serving the agenda of their master, Satan. This never occurs to them because they believe that life is all paradox and oxymoron. It's full of gray areas of truth instead of black and white truth, according to God's word. To the postmodernist, life is subjective. God's truth is objective. To them, truth is relative. To God, truth is absolute. To postmodernists, truth is existential. Now, existentialism is defined by the dictionary this way: a philosophy that emphasizes the uniqueness and isolation of the individual experience in a hostile and indifferent universe, regards human existence as unexplainable, and stresses freedom of choice and responsibility for the consequences of one's acts. God views existence just the opposite from that. What postmodernists fail to realize is that behind half-truths and heresy lie the work and kingdom of Satan. The postmodernist paradigm is then completely in the domain of the evil one. It was begun by him, and it's sustained and bolstered by his temptations. It's propagated by postmodern false apostles, prophets, and teachers, from whom believers are to test. True believers are to test because the spirit of Antichrist that pervades their teachings and actions. Postmodernists see no reason to test anything because they have been taught not to judge by false satanic teachers. But God says that we are to not to suspend our critical thinking, our minds that he created in us, but rather to submit them to God and use them to test the spirits. For a postmodernist to be saved, they must reprogram by the Word of God and the Holy Spirit to be able to think correctly. Their worldview must be entirely changed. This is why people like Leonard Sweet and other emerging church teachers are so dangerous. They cater to an evil mindset instead of attempting to change it through education in the Word. This is why we're living in the end times generation. The postmodern paradigm will bring in the reign of Antichrist, Satan himself. We can only thank the Lord Jesus Christ that it will be short-lived and that the devil, the first postmodernist, will be put down forever. The concept of the emerging church is advertised worldwide in books, the web, and TV by the likes of Brian McLaren, Leonard Sweet, Richard Foster, Dan Kimball, Rick Warren, Ken Blanchard, and a whole host of others, seeks to cater to the postmodern mindset while using diaprax to achieve its goals. The Hegelian dialectic is used in concert with praxis, and that's known as diaprax, to basically brainwash an entire generation into creating a new hybrid Christianity. This new religion is full of Eastern mysticism and Gnosticism, while systematically redefining the teachings of Jesus Christ, the apostles, and prophets with a subjectivist existentialist worldview. To achieve this end, any teaching and practices of biblical churches must first be vilified and exorcised. This is done through a process of thesis-antithesis, or the Hegelian dialectic. Orthodox biblical Christianity and its doctrines, the thesis, are presented as being stodgy, boring, misspent energy, misapplied methodology, and frankly, evil. The new antithesis is then presented, which is they take excesses pulled randomly out of the hat of modern culture while being careful to sound quote-unquote balanced in presenting those antithetical excesses as if nothing is written in stone and things are in a constant state of flux. The intended audience of 20, 30 somethings is then led to a middle point, or to a point which Leonard Sweet mistakenly calls oxymoronic. The ideas of the leadership of this movement can now present themselves as those who hold a balanced view, when in actuality it's often nowhere near any kind of balance. This is when the process of praxis, or consensus, kicks in. The audience is then allowed to express their opinion, to come to a consensus or praxis, as long as it doesn't stray too far away from the center balance, quote-unquote, which belongs, of course, to the leadership. Sadly, many have observed in this process, as in other cults, that if too many questions are asked, the person is then suppressed, and an attempt is made to reprogram them. If they're unwilling to come to praxis with everybody else, they are then told to leave, or are ostracized, or demonized. This process is exactly what cults do, what the Third Wave and Word of Faith churches do, what YWAM does, and is also what forms the basis for this new emerging church. The whole structure of the emerging church is defined by the Eastern mystical teachings of its leadership elite is geared around a diaprax model. Those who buy into it assume they are hearing the truth, when in fact they are signing off on the half-truths and outright lies of heretics and false teachers in the movement. By signing off, I mean that literally in many cases, as many of these churches, following the advice of Rick Warren and others, are having their adherents sign their discernment rights away in contracts or quote-unquote covenants. The dumbing down of America and the world is nowhere quite as evident as in the emerging church. Emergers are not taught to think for themselves, but to come to praxis. This is all done in a non-judgmental atmosphere, of course, as long as you don't fundamentally disagree. Since we already live in a generation that's learned to discern on the basis of feelings rather than the intellect used to study the Bible with the help of the Holy Spirit, the false teachers of this movement are free to put one over on the Christian public. But many emerging churches are simply parroting the thinking of their leadership, who apparently are allowed to use their brains to come up with schemes to, of course, empower and enrich themselves at the expense of stupefied, dumbed-down Christian masses that follow them. Though this movement is built on an evolutionary model of Christianity with the notion that we as Christians have somehow evolved to a higher spiritual plane, the fact is this movement is the tail end of a devolution of the faith, the falling away spoken of by Paul, which is called the apostasy. The emerging church is an idea which appeals to many youth today. In a modern society where fast food and blazing fast internet is the norm, young people also want a Christian menu as large and as fast as the internet. They want to be able to shop and compare religious practices and combine them into a religion they feel comfortable with. Gone are the days of hard truths and the ugly matter of the gospel message. Now Christian consumers can have their cake and eat it too. They can believe in a God of love without believing in a God of judgment. They can mix together practices and teachings from every religion while redefining biblical teachings in the image of their new syncretized religion of self-indulgence. They can comfort themselves that they have always been worshiping God in their cultures, as Don Richardson erroneously claims, and now they are just growing closer to Him. They can combine Eastern mystical practices dedicated to false gods and with the worship, with the true worship of YHWH. They no longer have to witness the gospel to people. They just can invite them to church and God will take care of the rest, or the pastor, whichever comes first. They get to do their yoga, martial arts, contemplative prayer, and still call themselves followers of Christ. They can continue to do anything they want in life as long as they have convinced themselves that what they're doing can be sanitized for their new emergent lifestyle, and they no longer need to be convicted of sin. They don't have to stick out like a sore thumb at work because they're being light and salt to the world, but can fit right in and disappear in the world. They can do all this and still claim they're the most anointed, evolved Christian generation that's ever hit this planet without having to admit, as they must know down deep inside they should, that they are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked spiritually. I'm going to talk about Brian McLaren and his use of Diaprax. Now, I had written a previous article called The Emerging Emergent Church and Their Use of Diaprax, briefly detailing the use of the Hegelian dialectic and praxis, which is called Diaprax, by New Apostolic and Emerging Church leaders. What I want to show in this article is a perfect example of Diaprax in the teachings of Brian McLaren, a main leader in the Emerging Church. Now, if you want to read the entire transcript of this video upon which this is based, called A New Kind of Christian Part 1, which, is, by the way, is one of the early videos establishing the Emerging Church, you can access it on deceptionofthechurch.com. And I also urge you to watch the video for yourself. When you watch, be aware of the intentional and perhaps even unintentional uses of brainwashing techniques called Diaprax. I will only quote certain parts of McLaren's teachings in order to emphasize the use of Diaprax as well as other teachings.
But if you're going someplace where no one has ever been, a map cannot help you. That's where the name off the map comes from in part. But another problem with maps is that sometimes they change.
McLaren makes his first point that Christianity needs to change with the culture and times. According to Brian, we also apparently need to change a change of operations manual, which is, of course, the Bible. The Bible is our map for true Christianity from the beginning to the end. What McLaren proposes is that over time, like geography, maps change, and so our entire perception of reality must change to keep in lockstep with the world. The basic fact that Jesus Christ never changes, that the truth of God's Word never changes, and is always applicable no matter what century you come from, and that Christians are to be light and salt in the world, working to change worldviews to a biblical one, is no longer part of the palette of the New Age, postmodern, emerging Christian. This opens the doors wide to new revelation, a new breed, a new paradigm, and of course, very old heresies.
I'd like to show you a slide of a map that changed. This comes from Honduras in 1998. A phenomenally strong and destructive hurricane named Hurricane Mitch formed in the Caribbean, started moving west. Everybody expected that it would move over the coast to Central America, as most hurricanes do. I confess to being a Weather Channel nerd, you know. So if this were the Weather Channel, they'd be making a motion like this right about now, and you know, but they expected this hurricane to kind of move west, and the eye of the hurricane would go over the land, and when that would happen, the hurricane begins to just disintegrate and fall apart. So you end up with a number of hours of extremely intense rain, and then a day of extremely intense wind, and a day or two of extremely intense rain, and then you end up with a tropical storm and a tropical depression, and soon the blue skies are back. But what happened with Hurricane Mitch was, as it formed, it started moving west, and when it got about 40 miles from the coast of Honduras, it stopped, and then for the next day, it just began to wobble. Day, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, for a week, for 5 days it wobbled, and then it moved over the shore. Well, what that meant is that for those 5 days, it was picking up all that warm, moist Caribbean air and dropping it on Central America. You may have heard a terrible tragedy occurred in Nicaragua, where a volcano, you know, that had formed over thousands and thousands of years from the ash of this volcano, creating a huge cinder cone. Well, that cinder cone of ash absorbed this rainwater day after day, and finally one day during this rain event, the whole hurricane slumped all at once, and a town at the base of the hurricane was just covered by the, a town at the base of the volcano was covered by the ash, and over 30,000 people died in a matter of minutes. They were just wiped out instantly. It was a horrific effect of the storm. In Honduras, in downtown Tegucigalpa, someone who was there told me that the floodwaters reached the 8th story of buildings. Can you imagine this? Because in that week, 100 inches of rain fell in Honduras. Now try to imagine, over 8 feet of rain fell in Honduras. And when that rain fell, it swelled the rivers, as you can imagine. This is the Choluteca River. And what you see here is a structure that used to be a bridge. We can't even call it a bridge anymore because, by definition, a bridge helps you get from one side of something to another. This doesn't help you do anything anymore because the floodwaters washed the road away on both sides of the bridge. And then when the floodwaters receded, the riverbed was in a new place. And so now this bridge is completely worthless, except that it has now become a tourist attraction, because people from the two villages that were connected by this road and bridge go to the end of the road and sort of wave at the people they haven't been able to visit in all of these years.
I doubt this last fact is true. They still had ways to see each other by boat, etc. This is exaggeration to make a point. But McLaren and the emerging church New Heretics have no qualms about using fabrication, exaggeration, disinformation, misrepresentation, vilification, prevarication, and even falsification to achieve a complete brainwash in their followers.
But I think this picture is a powerful metaphor for what happens in our world, because 100 inches of rain falls in Honduras every year, every 2 years. What's unusual, though, is when 100 inches of rain is condensed, you see, into a week. And I think change is the same way. Change is happening constantly. But when a lot of change is concentrated in a short amount of time, structures that used to serve become tourist attractions.
Okay, here we have a diaphrax alert. Here's the beginning of the Hegelian dialectic and McLaren's antithesis. Now, McLaren is now reducing historical Christianity to a tourist attraction that no longer speaks to our world, is out of touch, and in fact is completely washed out by the 100 inches of rain of time.
And the maps that used to accurately reflect reality don't reflect reality anymore.
So, apparently, the Bible, Christianity, and everything we stand for as followers of Christ is now no longer reflecting reality. The hint at the thesis of the diaphrax is that we need Pied Pipers like McLaren to help us to see the real map through our old, tired Christian haze. But you have to remember that this is from a man who only uses one Bible verse in his entire diatribe and demonstrates clearly that he does not understand the original map to begin with.
And then you have to start adventuring off the map.
We do not need new maps. We need to venture off the map. Just when we think we have to come to accept that we need a new map, McLaren takes his audience one step further in order to establish his thesis. The antithesis is old, useless maps. The thesis is off the map. The praxis is coming to understand that we need a new map. This reminds me of a segment on the Seinfeld show where Elaine and George wreck Jerry's car, so Elaine concocts a tragic story to cover for the slight ding in Jerry's car. By the time she's told Jerry about their close escape from death, antithesis, and then introduces the ding, thesis, Jerry is happy to hear that they only put one ding in his car. This is an old diaphrax trick, but one that works perfectly with people who don't use their brains, with those who are not mature in Christ and have no discernment.
If you go to that next slide, please. A good scripture, I think, that sets a framework for what we want to talk about in part this weekend is something that the Apostle Peter told the early Christians. He said, in your heart, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have, but do this with gentleness and respect.
Let's look at the context of 1 Peter 3:14 through 17 here, since McLaren never bothers to do so. But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear. Do not be frightened, but in your hearts set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. It's better if it's God's will to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. This passage is about suffering for the truth, not trying to change the truth to fit cultural or worldly circumstances.
And that phrase, always be prepared, I think is very significant. It's not that you can get prepared once and you're prepared forever. It would be like your software, you know. You keep getting upgrades.
According to McLaren, this verse is talking about getting constant upgrades to the truth. But in context, it's clearly talking about standing for the historic, unchanging truths of God's Word. In context, then, what McLaren is teaching is evil, though it's true that the Holy Spirit continues to teach us the truths of the will and character of God. The truths themselves do not change, nor do they need to be upgraded.
And he's saying you have to continually be upgraded in your preparation because people are going to continue to ask you new questions. A lot of our churches are very well prepared for the questions of the 1840s. Some are prepared for the 1950s. What we call contemporary churches are prepared for the 1970s. But there are relatively few churches and few Christians that are still being prepared to deal with the questions of the new century and the new millennium.
How does McLaren know this? He gives no facts to back this up. Is the gospel any less effective when preached today than at any other time in history? If more people aren't calling themselves Christian, is it the fault of the gospel or the fault of false teachers like McLaren, who would not know how to preach the gospel or have the desire to do so if a ton of bricks fell on his head? This is another example of antithesis, vilifying the past and present in order to bring in a new system of thought in the future.
And one of the real essentials, the Apostle Peter says, is that as we engage with people, we do so with gentleness and respect. And that's going to be our tone toward our culture. I try not to do this, but occasionally I succumb to temptation and listen to Christian radio. And when I do, it always frustrates me because the attitude toward our neighbors and the attitude toward our culture that I hear there is not gentleness and respect generally. It's an attitude of disgust and disdain.
I know of very few Christian shows, even the heretical ones, that reflect a bad attitude toward the American culture unless you're talking about the problem of sin being taught. Apparently, McLaren is not concerned with the problem of sin. He wants Christians to be so gentle that they do not even deal with the truth of cultural degradation. What he ignores is that Paul called the Hebrew culture dung in the light of the cause of the gospel, Philippians 3:8. What then is culture, Gentile culture by comparison? The problem with people like McLaren is that they've forgotten how to be salt and light, if indeed they are even regenerate, and are now preaching a gospel of tolerance in the name of gentleness and respect. You can speak the truth in love, but you must speak the truth. I do not hear Christian radio exuding an air of disgust and disdain, but rather of warning and admonition with regard to the pitfalls of sin, the world, the flesh, and the devil.
And so this weekend we're going to get practice in trying to look at our neighbors and our culture, including the people who don't understand or agree with a lot of what we believe. And instead of talking about how wrong they are, we're going to try to understand them and treat them with gentleness and respect and take their questions seriously.
Again, what McLaren means is tolerance without truth. When have Christians not taken non-believers' questions seriously? This is not true at all. The reason for speaking the truth to non-believers is that the very reason that Christians do and will continue to take their questions seriously.
In order to do that, let me try to give you kind of the history of humanity in about 5 minutes. Now, in order to do this, we will have to skip a few details, okay? But we're going to start our survey in about 2500 BC in what we call the prehistoric world. Now, I remember when I was a kid and they talked about prehistory, I thought, how can anything be before history? It was like negative numbers. I didn't understand negative numbers. I can have anything less than zero, you see. But when historians say prehistory, what they mean is before people had written history.
Obviously, McLaren is not a believer in written records passed down from before the flood, even though their lifespans gave them ample time to develop and use written methods. The records of Genesis are clear that they were records passed down through the line of Noah, Shem, Terah, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Moses. The literary styles of the different accounts, which are signed by the person who wrote them, are quite different and suggest that the records were likely in written form, not oral. I have written an interesting study on this subject. Christians don't talk about prehistory. The only evolutionists talk about prehistory. There's no such thing as prehistory in Christianity, as we have a book written by eyewitnesses going back to the creation and before, in the case of the information that God gave Adam about creation before Adam was alive.
And when you think about it, writing is an incredible technological advancement.
Again, we see he does not hold to those who come before us, and he doesn't hold those who came before us in higher esteem, and wants his audience to think the same way. We are led by diaprax to believe that the patriarchs were uneducated boobs, and that only those who are on the cutting edge of technology have the wherewithal to write.
In fact, this would be interesting to think about, talk about later on. But when you invent writing, you make possible new levels of economy, economics, new levels of government, all kinds of new levels of learning and passing on your learning from generation to generation.
So then the Bible must be faulty, and because we need to disregard the old untechnical stuff, we can be assured that we are the evolved ones who can decide what to do and believe. We can make our own rules on the basis that we are more advanced technologically. This is a tautological argument against based on a myth, but with the goal of schmoozing postmoderns into thinking they're at the top of the intellectual food chain. What hogwash.
The invention of writing is an incredible technological advancement. It's like 100 inches of rain falling in a week. It changes the world, and it gives birth to a new world that we call the ancient world. And this is the period that goes from about 2500 BC to about 500 AD. And because of the invention of writing, largely, you have these new economies and new political systems that become possible. And what you end up with are things called empires.
From approximately 4000 BC at the time of the creation to 2300 BC, about the time of the flood, people sometimes lived to be over 900 years old. Why would they not have developed writing during that time? Genesis 6:1 says people increased on the earth before the flood, and 2 Peter 2:5 says the world before the flood was called the ancient world, not prehistory. There is lots of biblical evidence that people before the flood were not dummies. Why does McLaren say the ancient world starts when Noah built the ark, and the Bible says the world before the flood was the ancient world? Also, some of the great empires of mankind are already in the past, such as Babylonian, Medo-Persian, Greek, and Roman empires. If we're realistic, we are living today in the times of the feet of iron mixed with clay, not the head of gold, from Daniel 2. The seven wonders of the ancient world remind us that we are not necessarily participants in the most glorious times of the planet, even if we do have technology.
And that the ancient world is a succession of great empires around the Mediterranean. There's the Sumerian, Akkadian, Egyptian. I'm sorry, stay with that previous slide. The Sumerian, Akkadian, Egyptian, Hittite, Assyrian, Babylonian, Persian, Greek, and Roman empires. And if you know anything about the Bible, a lot of those names are familiar because they're important characters in the biblical story. Abraham comes out of the Sumerian Empire. Moses, you'll remember, he brings the people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt where they'd been slaves for 400 years. So the story starts in the Sumerian Empire. It ends up for a while in the Egyptian Empire. You might remember when they resettle under Joshua and Caleb and the others in the land of promise. Eventually, the northern kingdom is conquered by the Assyrians, and then the Babylonians. It was in modern-day Iraq, and you've got a regime change in Iraq is nothing new. And after the Babylonians, you had another regime change to the Medo-Persians. They're the ones who allowed Nehemiah and Ezra and others to go back and resettle. Where the people resettled, living under a series of empires until the Roman Empire begins, and that's when Jesus comes. And the apostles, and they spread the good news of Jesus across the Roman Empire. But something fascinating happens about 500 AD. The Roman Empire ends through a whole series of causes. One of them, by the way, might be the spread of Christianity. Some people think that the Roman Empire ended because when more people became Christians, nobody could sustain the brutality necessary to keep imperial power.
Hitler had no problem sustaining the brutality to kill 6 million Jews. Stalin had no problem imprisoning and killing up to 30 million Christians, Jews, and other people who disagreed with him. I doubt this was the reason for the demise of the Roman Empire. Today the world is under attack from Muslims who want to eradicate anyone who will not bow to their false god. They have no problem sustaining their attack. The Bible says their power will not end until Jesus Christ himself returns to judge them and reigns from the throne of David for 1,000 years.
And so the idea is that wherever Christianity goes, people become less violent, and it makes that, you know, I wish that were still true. It doesn't seem to be true anymore, sadly. But around 500 AD, also you have these succession of invading barbarian hordes, the Goths and the Huns and later the Vikings and the Mongols. But around 500 AD, enough of these invaders come, and the Roman Empire is getting brittle and fragile. And the Roman Senate leaves Rome when some invaders come in, and they just disappear, and there's no government left. Now, I come from Washington, D.C., and a lot of people sort of wish that would happen there. But it's a mess when you have no government. Nobody's there to pay the soldiers. Nobody's there to take out the trash. Nobody's there to keep the mail going. And so the remaining nobles in the city come to the Pope, Pope Gregory, and they said, listen, we're in a mess. Could you help us? Could you help us run the city? And so something fascinating happens at 500 AD. It's like 500 inches of rain happening in a week. When you're done with that period of time, the world, the maps of the world are different. And the new world is what we call the Middle Ages or the medieval world. And it's a world where the church and the state are working closely together, where you don't have one dominating political empire, but you have the influence of the church in Western civilization, at least, being the glue that holds civilization together. And it's a fascinating period. It lasts about 1,000 years. But you get to about 1500 AD, and you have another convergence of phenomenal change. You have a new communication technology, the printing press. Writing was monumental 2500 BC, but 1500 AD, the printing press changes the world in phenomenal ways. You have new weapons technology, you have guns, you have infantry, you have cavalry that changes the world in phenomenal ways. Artillery changes the world in phenomenal ways.
The world had infantry and cavalry back as far as history goes, namely foot soldiers and mounted troops. This is just misinformation.
You have a spiritual kind of new movement, this Reformation movement with Martin Luther. Which Protestants tend to think was a good thing, although sometimes we all have our second thoughts.
Sounds like he's a cheerleader for the church of the Middle Ages, but not the Reformation. Apparently, McLaren is one of those who has his second thoughts about the Reformation. Why? Because his emerging church is totally involved with Catholics, and he has to be very careful about saying anything that would offend them. McLaren demonstrates that his type of gentleness and respect, quote-unquote, has to do with burying the truth instead of standing against the many heresies of the Roman Catholic Church since the early 3rd century.
Then there was new transportation technology. Man, that one changed the world. This multi-masted transoceanic sailing vessel, the caravel, makes possible all kinds of unbelievable things.
McLaren did not do his homework. Multi-masted ships can be found back as far as the 12th to 15th century in China, which had a huge fleet. They had ongoing trade ships as far back as the 9th century.
Remember the conquistadors? They come to the New World. They bring back literally boatloads of gold that makes Europe unfathomably rich compared to what they've been before. It also makes possible them going down and finding slaves in Africa and exporting slaves around the world, tragic consequences. It also makes possible the influx of huge numbers of new people into the New World. And so many of our ancestors came here and stole the lands of the people who lived here. Thought never crossed our mind that they belonged here and that they'd owned these lands. We just took them.
Well, Clarin is a master of generalization because stealing was not universally true of every European who came to the New World. This is the same line the Indigenous Peoples Movement uses in vilifying white men, including missionaries who came to help. One sign of diaprax is the use of generalization.
And in addition to taking the lands, we brought with us gifts, smallpox, and venereal disease. We killed millions and millions of people through our diseases. The world changed. The maps changed because of this new transportation technology, new ways of thinking we don't have time to get into, but a whole new view of the universe. In fact, if you go to the next slide, Copernicus and Galileo come up with this small adjustment in the map of the universe. Instead of the Earth being in the center with 10 concentric spheres, each of which holds some planets and stars, they make a slight adjustment. Let's put the sun in the center. And boy, with this, you have to hear, you know, shrieks of anguish, because people had thought that this view of the world with the earth in the center and the Bible went right together. And if you bring down that earth-centered view of the world, they thought the Bible, the gospel, the church, the Christian faith will go down with it. And there was bitter debate and bitter argument. It wasn't just the Catholics who opposed this. Martin Luther, John Calvin, they all were against Copernicus, and their successors were against Galileo as well.
Whose fault was this wrong view of astronomy? Not the patriarchs. Perhaps if those Christians McLaren mentions had read their Bibles, they would have known that the earth was not flat. Case in point, Isaiah 40:22. He sits enthroned above the circle of the earth, and its people are like grasshoppers. He stretches out the heaven like a canopy and spreads them out like a tent to live in. It was mainly the Catholics who opposed this view. The view of an earth-centered solar system was predominant in the Middle Ages, not necessarily earlier or later.
So amazing changes happened 500 years ago and brought us to this new world that we call the modern world. Let's say it's born in 1500. Let's say that it kind of reaches its adulthood in about 1750. And let's say right now it's in the prime of life. But many of us believe that in the last 50 years or so, a lot of us believe another 100 inches of rain has been falling and that our world is going through another major change in its landscape.
If the modern world is in its prime, how can it be changing again? If it's in its prime, which is debatable, then the next change would be devolutionary.
Not everybody agrees with this, but a lot of people, more and more people, are starting to think, yes, something's going on. And what we've grown used to as the modern world is now giving birth to some new kind of world, a world that's different. When you think about it, there's new communication technology. First, you have the telephone, of course, telephone. But then you have the television and the screen and then the internet. And it's very hard to overestimate how much the world will change because of these new communication technologies. It's very hard to overestimate it. In fact, I just was hearing recently about a theory that's out right now that says when you write with your hand, you write with most people with a right hand, which strengthens the left side of the brain.
What about left-handed and ambidextrous people? Apparently they are the stupid minority.
And there's a theory that's developing now that says when most of your communication is done, written communication is done through typing, what you strengthen is the interaction of both sides of the brain. And they believe that we're going through a major neural rewiring right now. Could be true.
McLaren debunks his own thesis by subsequently claiming that ambidextrous people are more evolved than right-handed or left-handed people. What about humans who have always worked with both their hands through the millennia? Why is this now some kind of radical new move? Maybe for couch potatoes, but there are many jobs that require equal use of both hands. I'm guessing that McLaren perhaps missed out on this experience, if this ridiculous sermon is any indication.
A whole new approach to science. How many of you were taught that the world, that matter is composed of protons, neutrons, and electrons? Yeah, I mean, that is so 20th century. You have no idea what they're talking about now. It's a whole new understanding of science.
The fact is, we're still eons away from understanding almost anything. And true believers understand that the more we understand, the more we understand that we don't know. Worldly science will always be a rat's nest of egomania and headlong conclusions without adequate support. This is because most scientists are spending their entire lives trying to prove that there is no God, instead of believing the eyewitness accounts in the Bible.
And we don't even have to say anything about new weapons technology. I mean, if guns and cannons changed the world 500 years ago, think about atom bombs in the last 60 or so years. And then think about biological and chemical weapons, and think about terrorism and suicide bombers, and you start to get a feel for who knows how that will change the world. New transportation, think about how airplanes change the world, cars, trains, automobiles. I'm not just thinking about the movie with John Candy and Steve Martin, although it was a pretty funny movie. New spirituality, whole new approaches to spirituality. 50 years ago, people thought that religion was on its way out.
You know what? The press thought God was dead. Yes. The true church? No. At least the church I went to.
50 years ago, people thought that science and government would answer all of humanity's questions and that religion, the sun was setting. But now everybody knows this spirituality is here to stay. People seem to be incurably religious. So our choice isn't between religion and no religion. Our choice is between good religion and bad religion.
There is only false religion and true religion, not good religion and bad religion. This is a very Pelagian viewpoint. Sounds like McLaren has been spending too much time becoming a Jedi, learning about the dark and the light side of the Force, and less time studying to show himself approved by God.
And then whole new ways of thinking that we could talk more about if we had more time. One scientist or historian, a philosopher of science, Thomas Kuhn, described it like this. When you have 100 inches of rainfall, you have a period of time where people have an old paradigm or an old methodology and an old way of thinking. Then there's an early transition period when people are very negative and very cynical and very critical. They're angry about how the old system doesn't answer the questions anymore.
Is he talking about a new paradigm or rainfall? If the analogy is rainfall, then when it floods, people just try to get out of the way and deal with the aftermath. If he's being true to his metaphor, McLaren is basically teaching that we need to get out of the way of this new paradigm and let it flood in. That's brainwashing.
And that frustration eventually gives way to a late transition period where then people start saying it's not enough to complain about how bad the old system is. Let's start dreaming about the new system. And that gives birth to this new system or new paradigm.
I think it's McLaren who is dreaming. The claim is made that the old system is washed out, those who support it are negative, so we have no choice but to adopt a new system we are all dreaming into existence. This is totally against the ultimate revelation and authority of the Bible. We are not to dream new truth into reality, but we are to apply the tried and true old truths of the Bible to our present circumstance and teach Christians how to think biblically.
And a number of people, I'm one of them, think that we're not in that new paradigm yet. We're far from there, but we're in this transition period. Some of us are in the negative stage. Others of us are trying to get a little more constructive, but we don't know what this new paradigm is going to be yet. But we're in the process, and there's this sense. The new road hasn't been built. The new bridge hasn't been built. But a lot of us are saying the old one doesn't seem to be working anymore.
What a statement to make. The bridge of historical Christianity and timeless truth doesn't seem to be working anymore, so we need to build a new one. This is classic Hegelian dialectic. Vilify the old, get people to come to consensus on the new.
A scientist looking back on Albert Einstein, a lot of his discoveries that contributed to the new science, said, A new scientific truth does not triumph by convincing its opponents and making them see the light, but rather because its opponents eventually die and a new generation grows up that is familiar with it. And if that's true in the world of science, how much more true it would be in the world of religion, where so much more is at stake.
So we cannot argue for the gospel anymore, but simply wait for the new generation to come along and redefine and live with what it deems to be the light? That's dangerous stuff. It spells the death of historical Christianity and the birth of new postmodern, subjective, existential, relativist, self-serving worldview that will basically damn a whole generation to hell because they've done what's right in their own eyes and disregarded the commands of the Lord Jesus Christ.
And so many of us find ourselves struggling with old paradigms and old ways of thinking. We really love that old bridge. And the fact that it's not working anymore really causes us pain. What we want to do is get out the bulldozers and dig out the riverbed and get the river back where it belongs and bring in some fill dirt and make everything the way it used to be. But others of us are saying, well, no, this is the new world. Change happens. We've got to figure out how to deal with it.
So to stay with his ridiculous analogy, we either have to, number one, stick to the original map, or number two, let the flood define the new map, and then we'll just have to deal with the reality when it comes. The message here is that the old is bad, the new is good. Therefore, we must follow the gurus who have a handle on how to navigate these new extra-biblical waters, like, as luck would have it, McLaren.
God isn't walking around in heaven going, oh, myself? What am I going to do about this? You know, he's not upset. He's not worried. He's not, you know, his blood pressure. He's not in a nervous breakdown danger zone. But rather, God is with us through all these changes, you know, these past storms, these past epical changes, these paradigm changes of the past. They didn't surprise God. And that we feel that we can cope with it. And so that's what we're going to be talking about this weekend. What does it mean to be Christians? What would it mean if you became a very, very effective modern Christian and then the world changed under your feet into a postmodern world and you were still practicing your faith for a world that no longer exists? What would that mean?
Here's the crux, the antithesis, the old is no longer effective. Thesis, the new has not come yet. Praxis, we need to go with the flow to be effective.
They're challenging questions and they're a little bit scary. But that's what we're going to be thinking about this weekend.
These questions are only scary in the context as presented. Out of that context, the Bible and Jesus Christ are the same forever.
I'm going to bring Jim Henderson up. And Jim's, actually what I'd like to do right now is, before I bring Jim up, is say a little exercise for you. I'd like you to stand up and find one or two people, preferably not someone you came with, and I would like you to just talk about what we've just considered together.
This is what McLaren has considered. Now he's using praxis, the final process of the Hegelian dialectic and diaprax, to get others to consider and come to consensus on what he has presented. This is the last step of brainwashing. If he's able to bring the crowd, which was very small if you watch the video, if he's able to bring them to consensus on what he's presented, then they have given up their own ideas and replaced them with those of McLaren.
Was there something that you thought was especially interesting or appropriate, or is there something you really have questions about or disagree with? But what's your dominant impression from this? And we're going to give you 5 minutes to have a little conference about that. But please do it standing up with one or two people, all right? No more than three in your little circle. And it wouldn't hurt to exchange names, too.
McLaren wants people to summarize, to find the dominant impression of what he has just said. There will be no real disagreement, as we can see in the later questions and comments. Thus, they are likely to agree with his basic premise, which is wrong. Christianity does not need a retooling to deal with postmodern society. Postmodern society needs a retooling to deal with the Word of God. Notice McLaren uses a pop song by an unbeliever to drive home his point that the people will need to chill out and stop acting like judgmental Christians.
In the aisle here, and here's what we'd like to do. What we want to do is find out, you know, we each talk to somebody, and I'd like to know, first of all, to start this off, what did you hear somebody tell you that you thought was interesting or insightful? And maybe you know their name. You can just stand up and if you just raise your hand. We got a couple mics here we want to get to. What did you hear somebody say that you thought was insightful or helpful or interesting? Raise your hand. We'll, you know, tell on somebody that you thought was pretty smart or had something interesting to say. Okay, nobody's smart, I see. Mm-hmm. Nobody said anything interesting. There's a hand. Would you stand up, please? Who's that?
Hi, I'm Jim.
We're not going to hand you the microphones.
Oh, sorry.
It's a rule. Nothing personal.
Sorry, Dan. I'm gonna share a little bit of what my friend down there said to me. But we were talking about how it's a general concept that sometimes this is a younger phenomenon, that this is kind of a youth sort of thing. And my friend here works with women's ministries very frequently, and she said that she is finding a lot of it also in the Oprah generation, as she called it, which I thought was pretty profound.
You thought that people like us wouldn't get it?
Yeah, well,
I understand.
We're
kind of surprised ourselves, actually.
Behind the ball on that. Yeah.
Okay, so that's interesting. So surprised that some older people get it. Anybody else had an observation? Somebody else? What did you hear Brian say you thought was interesting, or maybe you had a question about something you'd like to just comment on? Anybody have a thought about that? You want to stand up? What's your name, please?
Kathy.
Hi, Kathy.
Hi. We talked about how the comment about the Christian radio station caught us, because we feel like that there's a whole continuum on that as well, as far as from the very conservative to the very liberal and basically everything in between.
You tell me a little bit more about your question. You mean you caught, explain, go in a little more detail.
Yeah, basically you just made the comment about that you tried not to listen to Christian radio because you wanted to expand. I assume you were wanting to expand your horizons and know what other people out there listen to and this and that. But said even within Christian radio itself, there's that broadness too, that even as Christians we pick and choose which ones we want to listen to.
That's a really good point. Although it makes me wish I had your Christian radio station around, because where I live, there's not much of a spectrum. Although there might be variety in music, the content that's behind it, I think, is all very much a form of Christianity that made a lot of sense in the modern world, but makes a lot less sense in an emerging postmodern world.
So anyone else? Thoughts, comments you have? Yes, sir, the back here.
My name's Randy, and how would the phenomenon of the mega churches fit? Is that still part of the old paradigm? Mm-hmm. Because it appears to be quite successful in as far as the numbers of people that it's drawing, yeah. But would that be, where would that fit in that explanation?
Just for a comment on that, what he's addressing is in Protestant evangelicalism, for those of you that are not from that tradition, there's a phenomenon of mega churches and that have a lot of visibility. And so he's wondering about if they fit into the world that Brian's talking about.
That's a great question. Maybe my best answer for that would be, I'm for all kinds of churches, big ones, small ones, organized, disorganized, liturgical, non-liturgical, loud, quiet. I mean, I think they're all great.
Disorganized churches? The church is not to be one of confusion and disorder, according to the Bible. That's 1 Corinthians 14:33 and 40, James 3:16, and 2 Thessalonians 3:6 through 7.
But I think in the modern world, there was this hostility from the culture, especially the educated culture, toward religion. And the hostility basically was science and government will have all the answers, as we said. And religion was marginalized. It was seen as a personal, private thing. If you need it, it's sort of a crutch. Strong people sort of get on with their lives. And I think in that setting, it makes a whole lot of sense to get really big churches, because it's a way of us saying, we're strong, we're important, we're not insignificant, we're not marginalized. And I think there's a lot of momentum toward that.
This is dominionism. The fact is that the church will always be marginalized in society until the Lord Jesus Christ returns. We are a remnant, Romans 11:5, a little flock, Luke 12:32, a few who will find the narrow way, Matthew 7:14. We are to be light and salt, not dominant in the cultures. If this is the reason for megachurches and emerging churches, then it's the wrong reason, and the broad road and gate.
It's interesting as you move into a different setting where instead of saying religion is out, it's more like this. Hey, that's cool. Whatever you're into, whatever you believe, that's cool. At that point, then proving something by numbers becomes less important. Now, it doesn't mean numbers are bad, but what becomes more important is what do you prove by how you live? So I think the question that's going to be really foremost on our minds is not what approaches to church help us build the biggest churches, but what approaches to the Christian life help us make the best Christians? And if large churches can do that and small and medium-sized can, it's all great. But the question is, what kind of Christians are we producing? That, I think, is the one to really pay attention to. Great question.
Whatever you believe is cool? Is this what it means to be a best Christian? Are we the ones producing Christians, or is the Holy Spirit? We disciple, but we do not produce Christians. God does that through individual faith and commitment. Apparently, McLaren is wholly unaware of this concept.
Someone else? Question coming right down here in front. John? And this is?
I'm Steve.
Hi, Steve.
We were talking, and they asked me a question. I realized they were talking, and I didn't really answer it completely. They asked me, so what kind of church is my church? Is it a postmodern church, the church I pastor? Is it not a modern church? And maybe like a lot of people in here, the reality is, yes, it is all of those things. I've got people who are very postmodern, and some of them don't just understand postmodern, and maybe they're, you know, I've got some 60-year-olds who I would consider postmoderns. But the reality is when I, you know, when you teach or when you do church the postmoderns and of all age spectrums, then the moderns don't get it. And then when you do church to moderns, the postmoderns are like stinted, and, you know, I take it at some point you're going to talk maybe this weekend in this blended, you know, generational, this transitional stage. Man, how do you do it for everybody, you know?
Your book, Reinventing Church, addresses this issue, because your own church went through this process,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. It's actually the book's called Church on the Other Side.
Sorry, it was Reinventing the Church, pardon me.
Yeah, but listen, this is...
I guessed right, and I guessed wrong. Whatever.
You know, the situation that we face now in this time of change, I think, is very analogous to the first century church, where all the first Christians were Jewish, and they felt they had the inside track. And then the Holy Spirit messes things up and invites Gentiles into the kingdom of God.
This is a completely erroneous way to teach this. Bringing Gentiles into the kingdom has always been God's plan, Psalms 86:9, and the Jews should have seen it. On the other hand, incorporating New Age ideas so that we will be better Christians, or saying, whatever you believe is cool, has never been part of God's plan. The Holy Spirit does not mess anything up. God is not messy. God is the ultimate in order. This is heresy and blasphemy. It sounds like the teachings of other heretics like Tommy Tenney, Benny Hinn, John Arnott, John Kilpatrick, etc.
And now these inside track Jewish people have to welcome in these barbarian Gentiles. And we face a very similar situation. All the Christians in the world right now are either modern or pre-modern. And now we have to say, are we willing to welcome in these new people? And the scripture that always comes to mind in this is 1 Corinthians 13. It's not just for weddings anymore. 1 Corinthians 13 is really about Jews and Gentiles loving each other, people of different cultures. And so I'd say today, when we say, how do we get moderns and postmoderns, first of all, the burden should be on the moderns, because they're the ones with a heritage. They're the ones who ought to be able to be flexible and be understanding. But it goes both ways. They have to be patient, kind, not take into account wrong suffered, not be rude, all the rest. So that 1 Corinthians 13 is a great one for us to go deep with.
1 Corinthians 13 is speaking to the church, in particular the Gentile church at Corinth, and is not addressing the relationship between Jewish and Gentile Christians. It is how we are to act toward one another in the church and live a Christian life. This is not about accepting other religions and cultures as valid. That we are taught to love each other as brothers in Christ is true. That we need to accept the false belief system like postmodernism without question is not what the Bible teaches. So in conclusion, Brian McLaren is a dangerous teacher. The concepts he is brainwashing people with will indeed produce a new kind of Christian, one without grounding in the Word of God or the desire to obey the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the type of church system people like Dave Hunt warned us was coming in his book, The Seduction of Christianity, long ago, but few would accept that the New Age could take over the churches. The emerging church is merging Christianity with other religions in order to attract the world. But it is merely bringing the world to the world, not the Word to the world. If this type of teaching is successful in brainwashing this generation, we are on the verge of the complete demise of Christianity in our time. Then we will begin to understand the question Jesus asked with regard to his return. Luke 18:8, I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith?